Hello and thanks for staying with us. It's time again for Matters Arising. My name is Amechi and on today's edition, we shall continue with our review of the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. How far after more than 2 years in operation and how is it aiding the anti-corruption campaign? That will be this discussion segment for today, but we have other news breaking today we'll be sharing with you. Let's start from the Nigerian military. A new language policy released by the authorities this Wednesday in Abuja. It says officers and men must have basic knowledge, learning and speaking of the three big Nigerian languages before December 2018. Talking of Hausa, Igbo and Yoruba. Of course, before now, it is a worldwide practice among armies in which officers and soldiers are encouraged to be multilingual. Of course, Latin, French, Spanish are some of the other languages officers and men have been encouraged to indeed learn and speak. But this time around, the ability to speak three major Nigerian languages, the authorities say, will be an added advantage to those applying for recruitment or commissioning into the Nigerian Army. So prospective candidates are now encouraged to learn Nigerian languages other than their mother tongue. Of course, the military believes it will help in the operations when they are posted to different parts of the country, as well as indeed making sure that they operate and cooperate fully with members of their host communities wherever they find themselves. So, extra challenge for officers and men of the Nigerian Army. You must understand your country very well. By learning the language, invariably also learning the culture, of course, it will indeed speed up more friendly relations between the military and their host communities. I hope the other 250 ethnic groups will not indeed complain that their own languages are not being brought into consideration by the Nigerian Army. Now let's take you over to the State House, Abuja, where this Wednesday the president inaugurated a committee to audit all assets recovered by Nigeria's anti-graft agencies, and indeed all assets and monies, alleged looted funds recovered from the various individuals by the different anti-corruption agencies. And the president said his move in setting up the committee was informed by perceived gaps in the accounting processes. Of course, before now it's been apprehension and concern raised by persons, some Nigerians, over the status of recovered looted funds. So many people believe that most of the looted funds that were recovered were relooted. And some weeks ago, the president gave a directive on all agencies involved with recovery of looted funds to furnish with him full details of assets and monies in their possession. So the president may have noticed some gaps and has instituted an audit committee to try to see what actually went wrong. To our main issue for the day, but before then, let's give you the soundbite from the inauguration of the committee by the president that took place earlier this Wednesday.
The decision to inaugurate this audit committee on the recovery and management of stolen assets within and outside Nigeria today is therefore the next step in ensuring that all returns filed by the various agencies are accurate and consistent with actual recoveries made. The committee, in essence, is therefore expected to judiciously undertake an audit of all recovered accounts established by government agencies from the date of opening such accounts up to 10th April 2017. The details of the committee's functions are as set out in your terms of reference. Where it becomes necessary, the committee will of course rely on existing laws to compel the production of information and will also have the benefit of necessary interventions by the Attorney General of the Federation and Minister of Justice in obtaining such information through legal processes why are so required?
Well, it's a call for national duty. And as Nigerians, you know, we respond, we're ready. And, you know, by the grace of God, we'll fulfill all the requirements and to the standard required of us for this national assignment.
Nigerians expect us to carry out the duty efficiently, diligently, without compromise.
We'll not let the president down. We'll do our best to perform. We'll do our work to deliver.
Now, we hope that all the looted funds and assets will be fully accounted for at the end of the audit exercise. Now, coming to the main issue for the day, the status of the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, an act that came into being just at the tail end of the President Goodluck Jonathan's administration, is being on for about 2 years' time, 2 years now, and it is intended to expedite the administration of criminal justice in Nigeria. Just as with every other policy or act, it should be subjected to review periodically to identify gaps and challenges and recommendations on how to indeed improve on them. And Nigeria is a classic example of actions needed to indeed do so much to reform the criminal justice system. And this Wednesday in Abuja, a stakeholders conference opened where, of course, participants reviewed the life of the administration of criminal justice so far, act so far in Nigeria.
As we focus on the role of the courts in implementing the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, there must also be a corresponding attention to the role of investigators and prosecutors, as well as witnesses. No matter how well constituted the specialized courts are, they cannot achieve much without the complement of effective prosecutors and defense lawyers. A situation where prosecutors are not forthcoming with their witnesses or defense lawyers engage in deliberate delay tactics cannot augur well for speedy dispensation of justice. It is understood that lawyers have a duty to defend their clients to the best of their abilities. But a situation in which cases are frustrated through shenanigans, such as writing petitions against hardworking judges, or indiscriminate transfer of cases from court to court on flimsy excuses, on due prolongation of cross-examination of witnesses, and the like, can only frustrate the prosecution of cases and undermine the integrity of the criminal justice system, including the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. No wonder then that well over 2 years after the commencement of the implementation of the ACJ Act, the prisons are still brimming with awaiting trial persons, despite the brilliant provisions, innovative provisions in the ACJ Act, which can be used to tackle the problem of awaiting trial persons. There are a lot of provisions in the Act.
Professor Akinse George, dissecting the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, has been fully involved in the implementation of that act, as well as, of course, its review. How well, after more than 2 years, and how has it helped to help the anti-corruption agencies in the discharge of their functions and activities? We'll be raising questions around this after this short break. Please don't get away.
We should reach out and work in partnership with civil society, with the private sector, with foundations, with philanthropies, focusing on the need of the individual. Yes, states are important and their concerns are important, but at the end of the day, it is the citizens and the individual needs which are important. Huge problems like genocide begins with one individual, the humiliation of one individual. And so the focus on individuals and people is the right one. And if we work in partnership, and we all do our little bit collectively, we will make a giant contribution.
Okay, I'm now being joined by two gentlemen in the studios now to review the Administration of Criminal Justice Act after 2 years. First, from my far left, we have Dr. Benson Olubu, Executive Director of Clint Foundation. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Also in the studio with me is Vincent Adudu, legal practitioner and, of course, a member of the Center for Socio-Legal Studies. Thanks for joining me also.
Thank you, sir.
The Administration of Criminal Justice Act and the anti-corruption agencies. What has it been between this act and the functions of the agencies?
The act has been very, stupendously helpful in assisting the anti-corruption agencies in carrying out their functions. You know, and as you know, or as most of us know, one of the serious problems that our criminal justice system is facing is delay. And this has hampered the prosecution of the anti-corruption fight of the federal government in so many instances. And the act now has come in to introduce some innovations aimed at ensuring that cases, criminal cases, are speedily tried in our courts. And one of such innovations is the day-to-day trial of the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. Trial shall be from day to day. And where it cannot be from day to day, then parties have a right to 5 adjournments each, the prosecution 5, the defendant 5.
But have we kept to these rules talking about litigants, the prosecutors, and the defendants, especially in anti-corruption cases?
Yes, relatively, we can say that to some extent, some of these provisions have been adhered to. For example, recently, one of our federal high court judges was arraigned, you know, on certain charges before the FCT High Court. And the trial went from day to day.
Smoothly, and it was concluded.
And it was concluded. Now, the judge raised a no-case submission, and it was upheld. He has been discharged by the court, and he is back to his job now. So this is one of the testimonies to the helpful situation that the Administration of Criminal Justice Act has brought in the fight against corruption.
But there are so many other cases that have not gone that way.
Yes, you know, it is a gradual process. Our courts are congested, you know, because when we are talking of the implementation of the act, you also have to balance it with other cases in courts. It is not just anti-corruption cases that are in courts. We have other matters, civil matters.
That's why the Chief Justice of Nigeria had to designate some courts as special courts solely to handle anti-corruption agencies.
Yes, because, you know, the fight against corruption is not just the fight of the executive. It also affects the judiciary, and the judiciary is a very crucial agency. In fact, the federal government cannot fight corruption without the cooperation of the courts. So, and that is why what the Chief Justice has done, the Honorable Chief Justice has done, must be commended by designating special courts to handle these cases,
and so that they can be speedily the committee to monitor the activities
of these high profile corruption cases. So, we need to commend his lordship. So, by and large, we can say that we are no longer where we used to be.
Some improvements have been made. Dr. Olubu, what's your perspective?
My perspective is, I think it's a mixed bag. The law is there, which is a step in the right direction. But there are still some problems, which are also as a result of the criminal justice system we run. If you realize, the law is only applicable in the FCT and the federal high courts. That means that there are some states like Lagos State, Ekiti State, Ondo, Enugu, and some other states that have also passed state legislations, you know, domesticating the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. Like he rightly pointed out, there are some improvements, but the improvement is not holistic. And I think it also has to do with the system we are running and the fact that you cannot put something on nothing and expect it to stand. So if the Administration of Criminal Justice has to move the way it ought to move, then the reform has to be systemic and not just patches here and there. I also agree with him. We commend the Chief Justice of the Federation for designating some courts. But it also goes beyond the designation, because you also realize a lot of people have raised issues in terms of what really would the committee be doing. That is a big question. And also see, for me,
would they be interfering in the
that is the question, because you also see that some of the individuals who are members of the committee are active legal practitioners who have cases
before courts,
before some of those
these
courts.
Are some of the issues the gentleman that was initially nominated to head that committee,
Justice Salami, so for me it is a step in the right direction, but I think we need to do more, and one is that there should be a good understanding of what the law entails. We did a research, Clean Foundation did a research recently to understand how a lot of Nigerians feel about the administration of criminal justice and what has been the role of the ACJA itself. And what we found out is there's actually a low-level awareness about the existence of the law.
Among the populace.
Among the populace.
And they are the biggest beneficiaries.
And they are the biggest beneficiaries,
of,
yeah.
The provisions that have to do with activities of the security agencies, the police, for instance, and the rights of the citizen. But let's come to Vicente again. Let's look at the plea bargain, a special provision in the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. How will you say it has aided anti-corruption cases, anti-corruption campaigns so far?
Well, unfortunately, the plea bargaining provisions of the Act, you know, have not been actively utilized to the optimum. I cannot remember that any corruption case has been plea bargained successfully in the last 2 years. Well, I don't know if it has been done and it is not publicized in the media, but as far as I know, I am not aware of any. So that is an area that, you know, anti-corruption agencies need to look at. Because if you look at the plea bargaining provisions of the Act, it has brought in some innovations, some guidelines to ensure that plea bargaining is not abused, unlike what it used to be before the Act was enacted, where high-profile defendants, you know, deployed the plea bargaining process to escape justice.
There was this case I read of recently, judge, I think in Lagos, there was a plea bargain involving an electoral officer, but the judge said no, the terms of agreement falls short of recommendations of the law that is either they go back to renegotiate or the person should face full trial, is undergoing trial now.
Yes, the judge acted rightly, because if you look at Section 270 of the Act, you know, the judge is no longer a rubber stamp to just rubber stamp whatever is brought before him.
His or her discretion.
He uses his discretion to look at the contents of the agreement, to look at the recommendations, and to discern whether this is in the public interest. The case you are talking about is a case involving one INEC official. The proposal was that the man should pay a fine of 5 million naira and a fine of to refund 5 million naira and pay a fine of 500,000 naira, which the judge considers below the minimum stipulations of the punishment in the Money Laundering Prohibition Amendment Act, under which the defendant was charged. And if you look at Section 270, it says that plea bargaining may include a proposal for the sentence to be imposed on the defendant having regards to the sentence contained in the law under which the defendant is charged. Is there? So the judge acted rightly, because, you know, the judge has to look at how this will affect the public sensibility. I'm sure if that plea bargaining process had been accepted, by now the social media would have been awash with all kinds of criticisms and inquiries. So I think his lordship was on a firm terror.
In the past, Benson, we saw plea bargaining that Nigerians described as a mere slap on the wrist. Especially with the bank executives in the past, Nigerians were not quite comfortable. Now, any act such as the Administration of Criminal Justice and the plea bargain provision of it may be susceptible to abuses.
Yes.
So how has this played out since in the last 2 years?
Okay, so what you have now under Section 270 is a kind of what should be the role of the court, the prosecutor, and even the defendant. And there is actually a big responsibility on the prosecutor and in terms of the decision to actually enter into a plea bargain and get into conclusion. And the fact also that even when the decision has been made between the defendant and the prosecutor, The subsections under section 270 provides also that, like he rightly pointed out, that the judge has to agree, and it shouldn't actually be, it shouldn't be against the interest of justice. I think one of the key things there is the interest of justice, and that is why the role of the prosecutor is very important. So if you have a prosecutor who is not looking at the interest of justice and is looking at another interest, then the cause of justice is likely to be defeated.
The judge still has that responsibility to withhold,
yes,
and hold the interest of justice.
Excellent. And that is one of the things it has the Administration of Criminal Justice Act 2015 has brought up. It also tries to show the parameters under which such a bargain can be made. So one cannot come and say, for somebody who is being accused of humongous amounts of money, you tell him to bring like 2 or 3% and give him a very light sentence, tell him go home and sin no more. The law does not allow that. The law tries to balance the interest of justice and the interest of the victim, and also the interest of the society. So there's actually provision.
There's a tripod here.
Yes, there's a tripod here, and there's actually a provision for compensation, so that if money is gotten from the accused person, it can actually be used to give back to the individual who is the victim of the crime, depending on the circumstance. Sometimes it's the state that is actually the victim in terms of corruption cases and all those things.
Vincent, how do we effectively utilize the Administration of Criminal Justice Act in the fight against corruption?
Yes, in so many ways. First, the states that have not domesticated, it should go and domesticate, because there's no way a state can benefit from these innovations unless it is domesticated. And His Lordship, the Chief Justice of Nigeria, in the case of Bukola Saraki and Federal Republic of Nigeria, pronounced on the prime place of the ACJA in the criminal procedure justice of Nigeria. Now, we need, the Act says that proceedings must be recorded electronically. This will aid faster determination of criminal cases. There is witness protection and expenses. One of the reasons why cases cannot proceed in court is that the witnesses are afraid. They are afraid to come to court to give evidence.
We see situations where the investigating agency struggle to drag witnesses to
court
to come and testify,
because the witnesses fear for their lives, and we cannot blame them. You know, so the Act contains provision, you know, that will protect witnesses in that kind of situation and restore their confidence. We also have witness expenses. Some witnesses may be useful to the administration of criminal justice process, but they cannot come to court, or they have challenges, financial challenges. The Act says there must be provision for witness expenses. You know, the day-to-day trial that I've mentioned earlier too will assist in ensuring speedy determination of justice. In addition, the provision regarding stay of proceedings. You know, one of the major problems we have is that cases are delayed in courts. You know, especially high-profile corruption cases.
We are going to a higher court to challenge a ruling.
A ruling
to stay proceeding
on a very infinitesimal point of law that has no relevance to the substance of the trial of the charge. You know, we remember the case of a former Senate president in, I think, sometimes in the early 2000s, who was accused of corruption, you know, bribery and corruption in conspiracy with a former minister of education. The ICPC arraigned him, and you know, under that old law, under the CPC that was then operative, the judge has to give consent for the ICPC to prefer the charge. Do you know that the ruling giving consent was appealed from the High Court to the Supreme Court? And after 10 years, the Supreme Court said, go and start your trial. As we speak now, the trial has not commenced. So these are the issues, these are the things, if properly utilized, that can assist, you know, the fight against corruption.
Okay, Benson, very quickly, collaboration and coordination of the anti-corruption agencies, of course, how do we achieve that and help to use it to strengthen the Criminal Justice Act?
The Act provides for a monitoring committee. The Chief Justice of FCT should be the chair. They also have a secretary who is domiciled in the Ministry of Justice. But the unfortunate thing is that committee, the Administration of Criminal Justice Monitoring Committee, has not been as effective as it ought to be. And it should actually be the engine room of the process itself, because it is made up of it's a kind of interagency collaboration where you have most of the agencies that prosecute individuals in our courts. So you have EFCC, the police, ICPC, NAPTIP, and different agencies, the prisons. But because of lack of effectiveness of that monitoring committee, there is no coordination. And the reality is that we have interagency rivalry instead of interagency collaboration. And that is one of the things that is affecting the administration of criminal justice. It seems every government agency wants to take the glory.
And do it all alone.
And we know that it's one executive, it's one legislator, and it's one judiciary. So I guess one thing is that that monitoring committee should be empowered. And since it's a provision of the law, they should actually work. And they should know their responsibilities and have the opportunity to have this interagency collaboration, because it will help the administration of criminal justice instead of dragging us back. So for me, that the law is there is a good thing. But then we must ensure, it just goes beyond having a law. I think there's also the need for political will. So if you have a law that provides for a monitoring committee, as far as I'm concerned, the monitoring committee is currently moribund, then there's a problem. So that monitoring committee has to be activated, because if you remember,
who should have that responsibility of activating?
It is the government. It is the government, and you remember
which of the positions within the government?
It is domiciled. It is domiciled under the Ministry of Justice, okay. And that means the Ministry of Justice. The last time we spoke with the secretary, he said that they don't have any funding.
Okay.
But the question is that you are answerable to the Attorney General and Minister of Justice. So the Minister of Justice should be able to provide funding for the activation of that. And you remember also that there is a provision that every month or every quarter that the police should submit evidence of arrests that have been made to the Ministry of Justice. And that the judge, the chief judge, should also be going regularly to the prisons to take account of individuals who have been detained.
I think so, to some extent they are doing it now.
Yeah, they are doing it, but the thing is that there has to be coordination with the committee.
Okay.
The committee is the engine room of the Administration of Criminal Justice Act itself. But as we speak, things are not the way it should be.
Yeah. There's always room for improvement. Dr. Benson Olubu, Executive Director, Clint Foundation, and Vincent Adodo of the Center for Social Legal Studies have joined me to review the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, a law that came into place in 2015. But from every indication, so many loopholes, so many areas to be improved upon, and we hope that the authorities concerned will take quick action. Thank you so much for joining me on the program today.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for being part of it too. My name is Amechi Anapolesi on Thursday.